privilege and honor to welcome the ASEAN building at this event. On behalf of Comunicare Dotro University Press, which is the publishing arm of our university, I would like to express our delight at having been able to publish the book in Romanian translation and making it available to the Romanian readers. Professor Golding, it is also a rare occasion to benefit from your presence in Bucharest, and we appreciate your participation in the book launch and look forward to having your thoughts on the writing of this book and the drive underpinning your endeavor. I would like to extend a warm welcome to our guest speakers who have kindly accepted our invitation to be part of the event and share with us their opinions and insights on reading in pursuit of development. Professor Gabriela Dragan, General Director of the European Institute of Romania, also Jean-Monnet Professor, expert in European integration and university professor in the Faculty of International Business and Economics, Bucharest University of Economic Studies. Also, Professor Paul Dobrescu from the College of Communication and Public Relations within our university, Director of the Center for Research in Communication, and last but not least, author of the introduction to the Romanian edition of Professor Dobrescu's work. As publisher, allow me just a few words about the book's publication we are celebrating today. In Pursuit of Development, Economic Growth, Social Change and Ideas was initially published by Oxford University Press in 2016, so about a year ago, which makes it not only a very recent book, but one of Professor Golding's latest books. Why is it one of the latest and not the latest? Because at the same time, in May 2016, another work, which he co-authored, came out, Age of Discovery, Navigating the Risks and Rewards of Our New Renaissance. On publication, In Pursuit of Development and its author won instant accolades and garnered fantastic endorsements, both from the press and outstanding personalities, from Lord Nicholas Stern, President of the British Academy, Professor of Economics and Government with the London School of Economics, and to many others, just let me quote Sir Suma Chakrabarty, President of the European Bank for Reconstruction and Development, and Jeffrey D. Sachs, Special Advisor to the UN Secretary General on the Sustainable Development Goals, to name just a few. So far, translation rights have been sold to Spain and Romania, as I understand from our colleagues at Oxford University Press. The English edition came out in a very small format, a misleadingly tiny format, I should say, as this is indeed a very dense book. In point of the ideas it puts forward, the large array of problems it tackles, and vastly insightful in its analysis of the challenges today's world is facing. On the other hand, it is a book that is meant to be concise, accessible to everyone, to be held in the palm of your hand, a book meant to travel, to navigate beyond the confines of academia, a book which at times reads almost like a manifesto, a plea for sustainable development in a globalized world. Hence, I think, the choice of the cozy, almost intimate feel of the format in which the English edition came out. Now, coming back to our own edition, the Romanian edition, which we are launching today, Comunicare Dotro University Press and the National University of Political Studies and Public Administration are thrilled to have the opportunity to publish a work dedicated to a topic which, alas, is insufficiently covered in the public and political debate in Romania, and even more scarcely present in book format on bookstore shelves. We are happy to be filling this void with a remarkable book signed by a most prestigious scholar who aptly brings together the world of academia, research, and hands-on practice in top organizations. In carrying out this project, the University Press is particularly indebted to an excellent team of academics from the University of Economic Studies in Bucharest, who undertook the translation of the book. Let me address special thanks to Associate Professor Viorella Valentina, who not only translated part of the book, but also coordinated and supervised the entire translation and wrote the notes to the Romanian edition, and equally to Associate Professor Arcadiu and lecturer Elena Tarmacia. I don't think they are present here, but I really need to address these thanks. I will now press my introduction, and without further ado, I will give the floor to our guests for an in-depth discussion of the book. Professor Dragan, the floor is yours.
Between globalization opponents and apologists.
He said, I quote, "For some, globalization is a powerful force for poverty reduction and has led to leaps in life expectancy and other key dimensions of development. For others, globalization has negative implications and is seen as a source of growing inequality, poverty, unemployment." And he concludes that in practice, the flows that represent globalization can have both positive and negative impacts, and the final outcome depends on the policies and capacity of societies to manage these flows, ensuring that positive potential is exploited while negative consequences are managed and mitigated. Although Golding declares himself optimistic on our common future, affirming that is waiting for manifestation of modern Einstein or Shakespeare. I quote, "As over 5 billion literate and increasingly educated people begin to contribute to global development," he remains, in my opinion, prudently optimistic and warns that globalization is at the same time the source of greatest opportunities and most challenging systemic risks, such as climate change, conflicts, fundamentalism, or pandemics. The third question and point: in this very complicated current context, does the future of globalization represent a reversible process? And the question appears to be justified as long as, after a rather pro-globalization consensus of the 1990s, the last period seems to have reversed this trend. While a few decades ago, globalization was held by many to be an inevitable and unstoppable force, in the latest year, the future of economic globalization has been shaken by a significant series of political earthquakes. America First and Americanism, not globalism, shall be our creed, have been heard from the United States, while from France, Marine Le Pen declared that the main thing at stake is the rampant globalization that is endangering our civilization. And although in France, Le Pen had lost elections, the unexpected victory of Donald Trump, who decided, among others, to withdraw the United States from major trade deals, appeared to jeopardize the current global framework. And very recently, the prestigious journal The Economist, issue of 21st October, noticed that the reversibility of globalization, I quote, was a predictable result of political and technological change, one that governments in the rich world largely ignored, and their advisors and economists in general made too little effort to point out. Therefore, my last question, the fourth, will remain a rhetorical one. Will the next book of Professor Golding be about the likely or unlikely reversibility of globalization and unexpected evolutions that might take place under its umbrella? I do not know the answer, but I'm already looking forward to this new book.
Jan Golding's book is a synthesis of the Vermont. And as well as a reflection of the author's impressive practical experience. Professor Goldwin was vice president of the World Bank, program director of the OECD Development Center, principal economist at the European Bank for Reconstruction and Development, chief executive and managing director at the Development Bank of Southern Africa. For all this, the publishing house, Comunicare.org, decided to publish the Romanian version of this book. When I wrote the preface of Romanian version, I did it with a special pleasure, realizing that it is about excellent. Let me highlight some of the book's ideas and that have a special relevance for today's world. First, over the past decades, the debate on globalization has apparently reached a consensus, according to which the spread of globalization implies a unique, globally valid Young Goldwin's position is distinctive, I would say radically different. Let me quote, this book has shown that there is no simple recipe for development. The pursuit of development is necessarily shaped by a combination of history and geography. This major idea has a special significance to me. Every major country intends to show that its model of development is the best. It's not just a competition of models, but also a secondary one of evidence. If you are to judge things calmly, the power of a model lies not only in its intrinsic value, but also in its capacity to adapt to some particular conditions. Therefore, the generalization of a model of development is a very risky step, because it can have undesired results. Emphasizing diversity is extremely important. However, this does not mean underestimating common threats and certain universal requirements. Striking a balance between the between universal requirements and local potential is a lifeblood of this book. The right combination is a winning factor in the development equation. The potent combination is a word in the terms of Alan Greenspan. Today we encounter two extremes. The first overemphasizes universal requirements, the second local potential. These two extremes are two instances of fundamentalism in the field of development. The second highlight. Concerns the relationship between the economic and social aspects. According to the mainstream theory, development is an economic matter. Such thinking is so widespread because the measuring development of in economic terms is easier and seems to be beyond any doubt. When we speak about GDP or GDP per capita, anybody on this planet will understand us. Young Goldwin goes beyond and talks about the complex of factors, some of which are economic, some social. These social factors are for example, the social order, social ambition, the level of education, social cohesion, social distribution. All this maintains a confidence in the social system. The purpose of development is not just to raise the level of GDP per capita, but also to ensure the level of social content and satisfaction. In this context, he also discusses the core matter of distribution and offers us the example very, very instructive. The United States and Denmark have similar GDPs per capita. But while in the United States the richest 1% of the population earns over 20% of income, in Denmark the famous top 1% earns only 7%. That's right, social polarization in the two countries is very different. And so is the poverty and inequality map. Inequality, poverty, and the ways to fight them represent the author's favorite topics. A whole subchapter bears the title Main Poverty History. In these days, we deal with inequality between nations and between nations. Irrespective of where it appears, inequality across nations and within nations represents a main threat to contemporary development and poses a threat to the process of sustainable development, which has to leave no one behind. A third highlight. In Age of Discovery, a book that Professor Gordon co-authored with Chris Tarnow, we find a reflection that is very relevant for today's age. I quote, "Venice's greatest mistake was complacency in the face of increasingly clear vulnerabilities. We are in danger to repeat it. Our own complacency has two roots, lack of awareness and lack of urgency. Regarding lack of awareness, we need to acknowledge that nobody knows and controls the complex problem of development today. Yes, indeed, there are countries with a rich experience in the field of development. But when we speak about today's development, we need to realize that all of us have to practice a kind of apprenticeship. Regarding urgency, let me quote Professor Gordon again. Foresight is no one's responsibility. In this moment, the process of development suffers from a lot of ills. In our opinion, the most important urgency is to consider vision-driven development. We need to discover the strategic role of the state. We need to discover the fundamental truths that development involves great efforts in developing countries as well in developed countries. To make the present age a new renaissance, there are many lessons to learn. The first is the need for constant learning. To learn in general, in order to raise the population level of education, but to learn about development as much as possible. According to Young Quality, we are living in a learning context. Development is about learning what works and what does not, where and why. The second lesson, which is equally relevant today, is the concept among population. Look at the picture very well. This consent is declined in Great Britain. Is declining in the United States. Is declining even in Germany. Sustainable development is not a given. It has to be created, supported, and encouraged. Sustainable development means, first of all, building enduring premises of development. Sustainable society means, in terms of Professor Golding, a sober and non-partisan appraisal of the main problem we face. We could tell. This is a vital priority of liberal democracy. The book that we launch today ends with an assertion that, in my opinion, is one of the most comprehensive assessments of development. Let me quote. Development is not simply or mainly about the lives of others. It is about ourselves and what we care about. The life of a nation can be analyzed from many perspectives. The way in which it has managed to foster its own development is fundamental. Nothing else is more comprehensive. Development accounts for what a nation is and intends to become. That's why development is a genuine and enduring prayer of a cult. Thank you.
Thank you very much for this great honor of presenting my book here. Thanks to you, Olivia Sartet, to your publishing house for deciding to publish this, to Professor Dragan for her introductory comments, and particularly to Professor Paul de Brescu. I hadn't realized that because of you that this was here, so I have you doubly to thank about that. But also for your extremely insightful introduction and for your comments now. I actually think that I wish that I had heard that and read that before I wrote the book, because the way you put things is, I think, in many cases much better than the way I put them. So I really do thank you for your deep reading of the book and your ability to capture many of the ideas in it in a way which I certainly would feel proud to have written myself. So thank you for those extremely insightful comments. The reason I wrote this book was indeed because Oxford University Press came to me and said, would I put my thoughts together based on my understanding over a period of about 35 years of working on development. The only advantage in getting older, if you get asked to do this sort of thing, there are very few other advantages. But I saw it as a challenge. And I saw it as a challenge because what they particularly asked for is that I didn't simply focus on the literature and the vast literature which have filled libraries of books on different aspects of development, but also on my own personal insights from my career in very different circumstances. I've been fortunate to be both on both sides, if there are sides, of the development debate as a part of a government trying to do development when I was advisor to President Mandela and running the State Bank in South Africa. And then on the other side of the table, say the World Bank, but also the European Bank, when I was trying to give governments advice. And of course now as an academic, where I just think, get paid to think, which is a huge pleasure, and hopefully sometimes governments would want my advice, but that is their option entirely. And in thinking about this, I became very struck, as has been highlighted, by the complexity of this, by this extraordinary realization that although we have over 70 years of development thinking and literature, a massive amount of experience to go on, of many countries that have been extraordinarily successful, and many countries which have been extraordinarily disastrous, you would think that out of all of this we would be able to come to some clear conclusions about what works and doesn't work and learn. And that is the case. There are some general lessons, but I think the more interesting thing is that there's very little which is reproducible in a simple way. And so this is a very humble and humbling experience to try and synthesize my knowledge and realize that although we've learned an immense amount, there's a huge amount more that we have to learn if we do address these massive challenges which exist. Not only the challenges of over a billion people in the world still living under $2 a day, but also the new challenges, which are even more complex. The challenges of climate change and its devastating impact, particularly on poor people and poor countries, and for example, ocean rise, which will be associated with that, and growing fragility of land. The challenges of the future of work, when automation and robotics takes the routine and rules-based work. What is the future of the middle rungs of the development ladder if you're not going to be doing simple repetitive manufacturing, call centers, back offices of administrative services, which are now very much at the center of development for many countries? And of course, the rising risks associated with growing interconnectivity, pandemics, financial crises, cyber attacks, etc. Where the capacity of countries to withstand these is, of course, much weaker in developing countries. Poor people are always more subject to risk, whether it's in the rich countries or the poor countries. And so the great challenge we face is to ensure that this time, in fact, is not the time when we can look forward and say with great possibility that this could be a period in which we make poverty history, because certainly if past trends are to go by, that's possible, and that's certainly what the Sustainable Development Goals lay out as targets. But that this, it might be recorded in history as the period of peak poverty reduction. In other words, this might be the least amount of desperately poor people the world knows for many, many years to come. And we really see signs of reversal. There are more people living in poverty this year than there were last year, for the first time in many, many decades. So this is a worrying time, and it's a time when we need to ensure that we're able to redouble our efforts. My own personal view is that there's no more important question than the questions of associated with development. Why are some countries rich and some countries poor? Why are some people rich and some people poor? Why do some people have a life expectancy of 45 years and other people a life expectancy of 85 years? These are questions which go to the very heart of what I believe the purpose of politics, the purpose of communities, the purpose of learning is to ensure that we can share in the progress of humanity. These distinctions, of course, and these questions are not at all new. Aristotle puzzled over the meaning of progress, of well-being, of the purpose of governments, and that is something which has been at the heart of many philosophers, many political economists, and others in the millennia which followed. What's interesting to me as an economist is that this was at the heart of the concerns of people that economists look to for inspiration. And yet, this has become an absolutely marginal sideshow in economics. If you look at the work of people like Adam Smith, John Stuart Mill, Ricardo, Marx, and many other classics of economic thought, this was the central concern. And of course, those people did not separate economics and philosophy and politics in the way that we did. Indeed, many of them called themselves moral philosophers, even though economists today claim them as their grandparents of economic thinking. And what's happened, particularly over the past 50 years or so, is that economics has become absorbed in an increasingly, I think, wrong-headed, focused area of basically physics envy, where it tries to put into economics mathematical equations and formula which will present economic activity as if human behavior, as if human activity can be reduced to that. And indeed, I see that as one of the explanations amongst many for the financial crisis, the complete failure of economics to address the real world and the connectivity of the world. So development economics has become less significant over time. These concerns have become less central to economics. And it's pleasing that of all my books, you've decided that this is the one you want to focus on, because I think you must be ahead of the global economics curve in this. I believe it is absolutely central. Now, what's also been very encouraging is the commitment in the world to focus on this area. If you believe the statements of presidents, the Millennium Development Goals, the MDGs, the subsequent Sustainable Development Goals, are the first collective attempt by the world leaders to put development at the heart of concerns. And they have very bold ambitions. Many people are cynical about these UN declarations, and I also don't believe that the world changes because of UN declarations, but they are very significant. Because development is a team sport. Development is something that requires many countries, and within countries, many parts of the government and business and private sector to cooperate. And so when you understand what the common goal playing the same game, it makes a big difference to your potential of achieving the outcome that you're looking for. And that's why these activities are significant, because it is a global recognition and it is important. What I've always found fascinating, and Professor Bresco has pointed to this, is this paradox that if you pursue one particular development goal, you are likely to fail in others. In other words, it's vital to pursue a set of goals. Why is Bangladesh's life expectancy 71 and Zimbabwe's life expectancy 54 at the same levels of income? Why is South Korea 11 times richer today than Ghana when both had the same income in 1965? These sorts of questions are questions that require deep analysis and understanding, and also emphasize that the decisions that governments make really do matter. It's possible to be shoot yourself in both feet as a country trying to move forward and unable to move forward, but it's also possible to accelerate your development in dramatic ways. As Professor Bresco has highlighted, there's no simple solution at that. And one of the encouraging things that we experience in this moment in development thinking is a recognition of the pluralism of ideas and the need for both the state and the market and NGOs and society to participate. There were times, and of course Romania has lived through this time itself, when it was thought that the government could basically drag a society into the future. And that was also the view of the import substitution industrialization that took place across Latin America, Africa, and Asia in the 1960s, shielded by infant industry arguments and many others. There was another time in the 1970s and 80s where it was felt, in the early 90s, that all you had to do was get your prices right, allow the market to flourish, and everything would be fine, and that the problem of government was that it should get out of the way of development. And you experience that as well in the wave of change that happened after the collapse of the Soviet Union and the disastrous advice given by many development specialists and by the institution, the World Bank, which accounts for many of the ills in Russia today and the problems we see. Failure to design effective policies taking into account the specificity and also the dangers of capture, etc. So the pendulum swung from state to market, and the healthy situation I believe we're in today is that there's a broad recognition now that both are vital. And the debate really is about what can the state do, a recognition that the state is not omnipresent, is certainly incompetent in some respects, does not have foresight of the future, etc. And a recognition that at the end the market, the private sector, that has to create jobs. It's the private sector that creates taxes. It's the private sector that drives incomes and development and innovation. So they need each other, state and market, and the really focused debate has to be how, what, when in detail. And that differs by country and place, and of course it keeps changing, and in my previous talk at this podium this morning, I emphasized that it's changing even more rapidly. In other words, flexibility of state and market matters more for development than ever in history. And the reason is because the pace of technological change and innovation is accelerating, the complexity is accelerating, and therefore the dynamism of societies needs to accelerate with it. If you you stand in the same place, you are going backwards very fast in this world. And so change is not an option, it's a necessity if you want to embrace the future and ensure that your children and grandchildren have a bright future. But what change? Where to focus scarce government resources, financial and skill? What capacity can be allocated? How can it be renewed? That's the question that has to be asked in detail. And the same of the private sector. One of the great paradoxes in development currently is that while innovation is no doubt accelerating, productivity is stagnating. How can this be? Why aren't we seeing more rapid productivity growth? And that has to do with many factors, measurement factors, skill factors, and others, but also the failure of enterprises to renew themselves more. So the challenges are more intense. The one thing we know for sure is that the simple answers given by development experts of the past are less and less true. There were those development experts that said it's down to geography. Tropical countries cannot develop because of parasites, because of bad education, etc. We know that's not true. There were those that said it's down to history. Countries cannot develop because the institutions of colonialism or communism or others destroy the capacity. And we know that's not true. In fact, we know that all simple answers are not true. That in the end, there are so many examples of countries breaking out of historical straitjackets or geographical straitjackets and finding a dynamic future. That in the end, we know that this can be done anywhere. But we also know that the pace of change is very differential and the prospects are very differential. And one of the greatest challenges we face is that the main escape route for development historically has been closed, and that was migration. The reason we are here today, the reason I'm certainly here, is obviously because of migration. And that has always been the way that generations past have escaped dire poverty, famines, pogroms, etc. It's a third of Italy migrated, a third of Sweden migrated, a third of Ireland migrated. These were massive movements of people, much greater than the movements we see today. And of course, they went to the Americas and they went elsewhere. Now, with the creation of 100 countries over the last 100 years and higher and higher borders, except for within the European Union, that route is being closed. And so I worry a lot about the real prospects of development of countries where people cannot escape. I do not see what the development prospects are of Mali or Niger, other than people leaving. And how we think about these things and whether we are able to embrace them becomes quite central to their own futures. There's a series of new challenges. There's a series of challenges of interdependency, which I think increasingly will make us realize that what happens everywhere in the world matters to us. Some have highlighted the risks associated with security and terrorism, and obviously in the US that is a main consideration. But I don't focus on those primarily. I am more worried about other things like climate change, like pandemics, like fundamentalism, extremism. And in thinking about these, I believe that what's good for us is going to be good for others too. And that is ensuring that we are able to counter bad ideas and advance good ideas by learning more rapidly. Professor Dobrescu has highlighted the importance of this agenda. What we see in a world of fake news, And so my hope in development is that by learning more rapidly, by focusing on the evidence, by understanding that our veil of ignorance has been lifted in a way that we cannot ignore, we see what's happening. No one can say today they don't know that climate change is happening. No one can say today they don't know what's going on with the Rohingya refugees in Myanmar. No one can say today that they don't understand why people are coming and leaving from Syria. We have no veil of ignorance left. Because of the new transparencies of information, because we are experiencing collective tragedies of the commons, like in climate change, antibiotic resistance levels, we have a joint and collective responsibility. So I end the book, as Professor Dabrisku has highlighted, arguing that in the end, development is not about other people. Of course, that's a very important part of it. But I believe very deeply that the reason we should care about it is not only because we care about other people in some other place for ethical or other reasons, but because we care about our own societies, our own communities, and ourselves. Our futures will depend on what happens around the world. And by focusing on development, we ourselves will develop ourselves and their futures. Thank you. Thank you.